The foulness in the air kept Moore from being able to pinpoint the smell. But it's clear now that she has an extra passenger, a hidden creature, smelling of rotting prey and wet fur. Moore stares at the creature, assessing its glare. She won't start a fight. She has no time to nurse an injury. It's not even doing anything. It's just sitting around. Agreed to stay back home whenever Moore needed to go below. But more and more frequently, the only thing left at home are fights. Miri fails to grasp the importance of Moore's work. Who else could do the things her sister has to do? Instead of valuing Moore's sacrifice, Miri is just being a burden. Miri has been diligently growing crops ever since Moore could remember. No blight could take her down. She'd always start anew. There would be lines each month for the fresh harvest. Moore had always found small spots comforting. Young Moore would squeeze herself into little caves, and find their hidden secrets. Few others are interested in such mundane mysteries. Which one are you? Apollo? Rudy? Maybe Juno? Millie named every chicken, but they all look the same to Mo. Does the world have to end for you to come and visit me? Millie jokes at her younger sister, her sarcasm masking her disappointment. Millie tries to reach through and speaks earnestly. It's nice to see you, Moore. I missed you. And she asks Moore to come in for stew. But as if unjustly charged for a crime, Moore defends herself, pushing Millie away. I only came to make sure that you're doing okay. Miri nods. She spent all morning trying to bring her animals inside. She reaches out once more to Mo.
I can help you. I'll get ready, and I'll come too.
No, Mo cuts her off. I'm quicker without you tagging along. I got this. You take care of your chickens. They used to be our chickens. Millie snaps in frustration. You used to care. What even am I to you? For more, it's just another confrontation on the island's surface. Another angry outburst from her irate sister, making more long for the calm and dark below. But for Miri, it is one more ill-fated attempt to get her sister back. If you leave now, I won't be here when you get back. I mean it this time. Miri prefers her tea dark and bitter, to wake her in the early hours. Mo would much rather sleep in and stuff herself with the sugary walnut cookies. Mo remembers watching the stars streak across the sky. Miri's face lit by the moonlight, full of wonder, both wrapped up warm in their duvets, their shared silence saying everything they needed. Mo and Miri had a system for the beds, but now Miri always sleeps on the top bunk. Miri retrained herself to play the cello after the fungus ate her arm. Moore never found the right moment to say how impressed she was. Moore hated the rust bucket of a bath, but it was still preferable to cutting your feet on the rocky beach again. One is Fridolin, Moore recalls, the one that runs away. Fridolin will escape again, but he just needs his own space. Moore can sympathize with that. Moore can hear the silence under the island's crust, machines aching, begging her to fix them. Thank you.
I won't be here when you come back. I'll leave you on this forsaken piece of rock. How many times has Miri threatened to disappear? Not once going through with her word. She always comes around in the end. For a moment, Moore regrets not going back to get her mask, but she's never been one for moving backwards. Even in this vision, conjured by the fungus in her lungs, the way out is forward.
Thank you.
The lighthouse that once brought travelers home, trade to these islands, and customers to the tavern, now stands still. Mor can see Hymer from here. She wonders if the lights are on in their tiny house. Gate to the lighthouse. As long as Mor can remember, the lightkeeper was always on duty, saving sailors from the sharp rocks surrounding these islands. But since the Great Exodus, he has been drowning, touching glasses with whatever phantoms are left at that watering hole. Slope awaits inside the cave. Its ground was a friendly acquaintance to many drunk patrons.
She remembers playing with his son, how they would swim between the rocks, how his wife would bring them inside and warm them up with a bowl of soup and her smile. Moore wonders if he remembers too. Only a ghostly murmur from under his mask and a ghastly stench. A key glimmering in his satchel. Come to her senses. Mo will have some stew.
A hole in the floor, too big for one man to fill alone. A gaping maw, slowly devouring both man and lighthouse. And still, he stubbornly refuses to accept anyone's help. Nostalgia sharply tugs at Moore's heart. I forgot how much I missed the sky and stars. His wife wouldn't risk losing the boy to the Blight, but he decided to remain this island's lightkeeper, unable to bear losing what purpose he thought he had. So they set sail without a father.
A gentle vertigo crawls over Moore's body, the satisfying tingle of light danger, one of her favorite sensations. Moore takes in a final breath of Leusa's air. Much better, she congratulates herself. Now your chickens can come back out, sister. She does not expect gratitude from her sister, or an apology, but Moore does expect to be welcomed home. Thank you.
Now that the air is safe to breathe again, Miri must have calmed down and gone to make sure that the stew is still warm. Food is always her way of apologizing. Bergan's muscles soon will power these engines again. It is his duty, and his duty alone, to keep the veil over Heima strong. Mor will make sure he honors it. Thank you. all the minutes you have squandered and misused for sentimental distractions. How will you make up for everything you have wasted? You are beyond these tools now, so primitive and human. You are the bearer of the Omni Switch. But deep down, you know and understand. You are far from worthy of it.
Dead things in frames. A petty attempt at preserving beauty. How can you occupy yourself with that? With the lives depending on you? Maud doesn't dare to read it. What possible use could reading it have right now? It's all been said, not by the letter or its contents, but by the gemstone left behind. Annoyed, Maud steels herself once more for the visions. These feverish dreams have never been so frequent, never been so hostile.
Thank you.
hasn't seen her grandmother for a while now, but Granny would never make a scene about it. Yet Moore feels anxious stopping by. Not because she doesn't like her. She likes the old woman too much.